Fantastic. Thank you all for being here. May is for memory, and so is November, ritualizing spring and winter in the seasonal cycle of life and death. Here at Liberty Memorial on Armistice Day in November and Memorial Day in May, Kansas City people gather by tradition, just as we are this May evening, on a pilgrimage to remember. From here, 98 years ago, this month, the people who remembered processed through the streets of Kansas City to lay wreaths at two American Legion memorials. American Legion 1 at the junction of 9th and Main, and American Legion 2 behind the flagpole of Shelter House Number 1 at the entrance to Swope Park. From here, the mourners carried wreaths to the graves of their boys brought home from the American cemeteries in France to rest at Mount Washington, Forest Hill, Mount St. Mary's, and Elmwood. In a symbolic way, where we are now, in this cavern below the stone monument of Memory Hall, we remember above us, inside on the west wall, the names of 440 Kansas City men and one woman, Nurse Lottie Hollenbach, who died in the war. And today, the centennial of the first Memorial Day week after the armistice, we gather to remember the men and women, firsthand witnesses who wrote the stories and remembered for the people at home, the men and women who served in the trenches, the YMCA huts, base hospitals, ambulance units, telephone exchanges, artillery placements, and supply channels during the war. And one of those journalists was 27-year-old Otto Paul Higgins, correspondent for the Kansas City Star at Camp Funston on the Fort Riley Reservation near Junction City, Kansas, with the 89th Division, at Camp Donovan in the Fort Sill Reservation near Lawton, Oklahoma, with the 35th Division, and in England and Ireland with the destroyers and subchaser crews, then in France and Germany with the 35th, 89th, and 42nd Division on infantry, artillery, hospital, and ambulance, field signal and ammunition trains on the ground, and fixed wing and reconnaissance dirigible units in the air. In the 14 months between May the 1st of 1918 and July 2nd, 1919, and the Star published approximately 218 dispatches, totaling 198,665 words. Added to that are 74 photos, most of which were published, but some appearing here in this book for the first time after remaining in a steamer trunk for over 90 years. Most of Higgins' subjects returned to the United States after the war and are buried here, but some lie still in cemeteries in England and Ireland, France and Germany. His readers, too, are gone by now. But 100 years ago, they were the audience for the Kansas City Star, a regional newspaper with morning and multiple evening editions distributed throughout seven states in the middle of America. The original dispatches, however, remain on microfilm, archived, and here in print in this book, along with selection of articles, the total a little bit more than 97,500 words, I gathered and edited over a period of 10 years. Added to that are a selection of the photos that Higgins took, additional pictures appearing in contemporary unit histories as he read, maps and postcards of the areas that he describes, and extensive annotations of the allusions he makes to the areas he visited on the battlefields and in the places in Kansas City he remembered as comparisons for the people at home. Front lines to headlines, sword and pen. But rather than a sword, rifle, or automatic, or a bag of hand grenades, he carried a reflex camera, Graflex camera. A case for paper, and a notebook. And a portable typewriter with telescoping tripod legs. And there you see those legs there. And there's the typewriter. Here, he is at work on the typewriter. And you can see the tripod there, and there's the machine. And this was a Signal Corps photo of war correspondents. Only one candle tonight, he says. Have it sitting on a bench, then a roll of toilet paper, then a tin can, and then the candle, so I can see the keys on my machine. But we don't mind little things like that over here anymore. Don't know what I would do with electric lights. Candles furnish mighty good power, and I always carry two or three in my musette bag. And here he is with all that gear packed together and at the ready, armed for a mission to get the story of Kansas City in the Great War. Now let's take a look at how he used that camera, notebook, typewriter, and his legs to get the story for the readers at home. Through the lens of his camera, Kansas City for the first time saw up close the war it had sent its young women and men to fight. Typically, Higgins took the pictures and had the film developed in Paris. Here, this packet of negatives was developed by Charles Meyer. 27 Rue de Pyramide, and that is right there. If you're familiar with Paris, you recognize Le Jardin des Tuileries, and this is where Otto lived when he was in Paris. He had a room there. Across the street from the Tuileries, just a few blocks from where he stayed there, Hotel Lotti, 7 and 9 Rue de Castillo, right there. So it was a trip down here and up there. Here's the Hotel Lotti envelope Otto addressed to his mother, Delia Higgins, on 6 September 1918 and posted at Saint-Roch just a few days before the Battle of Saint-Mihiel, about which you will hear more as our story continues. While on another envelope, Charles Meyer advertised the versatility of the Kodak autograph model camera OPH was using with specialized film cartridges that resembled gun shells. So, film cartridges loaded, Higgins shot the following four pictures on Tuesday, June 18, 1918, immediately following action by the 5th Marines. Higgins and Adam Breed of the Hastings, Nebraska Daily Tribune had received extensions of passes from 42nd Chief of Staff General Douglas MacArthur to be the first American correspondents to see the Marines in action at Belleau Wood. A Boche position, Higgins wrote on the back of this photo, and then he went on to explain, the two men who were shooting the rifles seen on the parapet were lying dead in the dugout when this picture was taken. The short stocks on the right are hand grenades. It was what Higgins wrote, that what you don't see, that stands out in your vision. On the map, Belleau Wood is here. It's 28 miles from Chateau Thierry. Paris is over here someplace, down in on the left. So this area is northeast of Paris. Note the sensor stamp here on the right. So after Higgins had taken the pictures, he had them developed and the cut lines he'd written on the back, and he sent the photo along to the sensor. The next picture followed and continues the intimacy of what it is that you don't see. This is their home, Higgins wrote. Just big enough to sleep in or sit up, he continued. And today, 100 years later, the remains of this same or similar home is still visible in the Bellow Wood. A machine gun, abandoned by the Boche in their retreat, Higgins wrote. It is standing just as it was left, a witness, we imagine, still warm to the touch. And a grim reminder of the crew who manned that weapon, quote, the remains of a Boche machine gun crew, Bois de Belleau, unquote. Again, it is the witness of what we don't see that stands out in our minds. In Kansas City, did not see these original photographs and their cut lines until 3 months later, on September 22, 1918, 4 days before the Battle of the Meuse Argonne, accompanying an article that OPH had written a month earlier, August 12, 1918. The time lapses reflect the requirements of getting the film back to Paris, waiting to get it developed, passed on to the censor before being sent by mail back to the Star Building at 14th and Grand. The following four photos were also taken by Higgins that same day as the other four and sent to the Star with cut lines, but pictures and text did not appear in the paper with the other photos and cut lines and now are published in this book for the first time. And now we see the point of view of the men themselves. These men, Higgins wrote, are camped on the edge of the Bois de Belleau where they can easily see the Boche position. Top line, eating supper while watching the Boche. And they are also watching the cameraman, as you can see from there. Boche equipment left behind in the retreat in Bellow Wood passed the AEF sensor on A27, France, 1st of July, 1918, in vivid detail. And again, a grim reminder of the cost. Carrying wounded, Otto wrote, out of the Bois de Belleau, note the glance of the one man whose awareness makes the viewer a conscious witness to the scene. Passed by the AEF sensor 27 on France, July the 1st of 1918. And in contrast to carrying the wounded in this picture, of quote, carrying water to the advance lines, Bois de Belleau. It takes a 3-hour hike, Higgins wrote, to reach the edge of the woods from regimental headquarters. The Boche occupied the entire wood and were driven out, unquote. On the edge of that woods today is the Iron Mike Memorial, whose witness is constantly at the ready for the Marines and the infantry, who drove out the Boche that Tuesday, June 18th, 1918. He leads the viewer into the fight. In 95 years after the battle, on 30 September 2013, 7 American veterans of World War II, Korea, Vietnam, and the Gulf Wars, and our guide, a British veteran of the conflict in Northern Ireland, had a picture made with Iron Mike there in the Bellow Wood. We were on the National World War I Museum's battle tour of 2013 and had just finished struggling through the woods and were emerging into the wheat field just beyond. I'll never forget that day as my gaze swept over the wheat field and I wondered what else I couldn't see that Otto must have seen 95 years earlier when he was in that very place taking those pictures. And I took pictures too with my digital camera in the woods where so many American boys were cut down in the grim harvest of their young lives. The readers of the Star must have been afflicted just as I was by what they realized they couldn't see. When they looked into the pictures Otto took of the machine gun, the foxhole, the parapet, and read the words of his witness, that the two men who were shooting the rifles seen on the parapet were lying dead in the dugout when this picture was taken. Such was the closest a correspondent could get to photographing actual bodies, which the censors would not permit to be published for fear of the impact doing so would have on the home front. But the reality of those pictures, Higgins's description of a raid that he joined one night crawling across no man's land, had such a strong impact on the reader A.F. Killick wrote a letter to the Star. "I think OPH's story in the Sunday Star had more real stuff in it than anything that has so far been chronicled either by volunteer or regular writers," Killick wrote. "He told the things that lots of us bulletproof, bombproof, famine-proof mutts have been wondering how it felt in a way that could not be mistaken. Several people with whom I talked today expressed similar sentiments." A.F. Killick. In recognizing the viewpoint of witnessing what he couldn't see, Killick touched on another essential quality of good reporting. Higgins had the legs of a good reporter. "With the news instinct must come industry," William Rockhill Nelson said. "Often a good pair of legs makes a good reporter. The newspaper man must always be on the job, always hustling, always ready to go to any inconvenience or suffer any fatigue to get the news." Here, Higgins expresses the dexterity and willingness of a good pair of legs. And Killick's reaction to Higgins is exactly what Kansas City Star owner and publisher William Rockhill Nelson wanted to elicit in the readers of his newspaper. From the very beginning of the paper, Nelson had, quote, "brought to his work the viewpoint of the readers rather than that of the technical newspaper man. Believe the people," he would say. "No man with even ordinary judgment ever went wrong assuming that the people will support the best that is furnished to them," unquote. For Nelson, what was needed in reporting was initiative and imagination. The man who has the imagination to see a real story in an apparently commonplace happening and the initiative to go after it and develop the story is the sort of man every newspaper is looking for. Here you can imagine that Colonel and ex-President Theodore Roosevelt agrees with his friend William Rockhill Nelson on that very point. Roosevelt himself wrote articles about the war for the Star, and they were syndicated from Kansas City. Writing ability, as important as what it was, came secondary, Nelson thought. "If, in addition to these abilities, comes a knack for writing," Nelson said, "so much the better. The fortunate possessor of this combination is on the way to fame. But the ability to write is common and less valuable than the ability to dig out the news." Time after time, Higgins demonstrated his ability to dig out the news. And in the process of witnessing, he brought his reader into the point of view and revealed there the personal character and emotional intensity of the Missouri and Kansas men who lived and died in this fight. Two such men were Lieutenant Colonel Clay Campbell McDonald and his son, First Lieutenant Donald Malcolm McDonald. Note how Higgins keeps after the story, establishes the reader into the point of view, and makes us witness the story. Camp Stewart, Virginia, April 29th, 1919. Two officers of the 35th Division were father and son. The boy, Lieutenant Malcolm Donald McDonald, was adjutant of the 3rd Battalion of 139th Infantry, composed of the old 4th Missouri and the 3rd Kansas. The father, Major Clay C. McDonald, was division postmaster. Major McDonald was 64 years old. Too old, the medical officer said, to be an efficient line officer. "He can't stand the gaff," they reported. "He's sound physically, but he wouldn't be able to withstand a strenuous job in France." Therefore, Major McDonald was to be left behind. Maybe to remain in the Army, maybe to be discharged and sent back to his home in St. Joseph. This plan did not suit the Major. He had been on the guard for a number of years, and now that something was going on, he wasn't going to be left out. So he went to work on it, and in the end was able to go to France as postmaster of the division, attached to division headquarters. Whoa, come back. Okay, there. He went away for a while, but he came back. Lieutenant McDonald, his son, had a reasonably good job too. In the ordinary run of things, a battalion adjutant is fairly safe. He runs a lot of chances, of course, they all do, but he doesn't have to go out on night patrols or lead his men over the top or capture machine gun posts or take any unnecessary chances like the other lieutenants of a battalion. It's his duty to remain at headquarters and handle the paperwork and look after other things in general. But this did not suit Lieutenant McDonald. Shortly before the Argonne, he went into Colonel Carl L. Rasteen, regimental commander, and had a talk with him. "I want to get a platoon," he told Colonel Rasteen. "I've been battalion adjutant a long time. I'm perfectly familiar with the work, but it's too quiet. Here are all the rest of the fellows going out on patrols, over the top, and I have to remain behind and read their reports and forward them. I want something to do myself. I want to lead the men." Colonel Rasteen told him, "It'd be all right with regimental headquarters if the battalion commander acquiesced." The battalion commander did, and just before the troops went into the Argonne, McDonald was placed in command of a platoon. The division jumped off on the morning of September 26, 1918. Here is an original map showing the advance that day. So they're down here at Vauquois Hill. There's Varennes, Chappie, Very, Charpentry, Bulny, and up in here, Exermont. And we'll see in a little bit further. They were right in front of Vauquois Hill. That famous hill that the Boche had mined and tunneled until it was practically a shell. And a shell that was so full of machine gun nests and other death-dealing implements of war that the French said it could never be taken. So when the attack was made, the troops passed on either side of it, closing in on the far side. But it was alive with Boches. And it was left to a battalion of the 139th Infantry to go right straight up that hill from the front and take it, which meant silencing the machine guns and killing the gunners. This is a picture from the 139th Infantry history. Lieutenant Malcolm Donald McDonald was leading a platoon right up the face of that hill, paying no attention to the machine guns that were spattering on every side, mowing down his men. He was right out in front, and his men were following. He was doing just what he had wanted to do: lead his men into battle. And he was doing it gloriously. Machine guns, barbed wire, artillery mines, nothing could stop it. A Boche machine gunner got the range of the platoon. Lieutenant McDonald was the first to fall. A sergeant jumped in his place. The attacking wave went on. Another followed it, and still another. The hill was taken. The machine gun nest quieted forever. The tunnels cleaned out. The artillery silenced. When they returned, Lieutenant McDonald, the first of his regiment to fall in the battle, was dead. The surgeon said death was instantaneous. The battalion carried on. Men have no time for sentiment during a fight, and when one falls, another takes his place and continues the onslaught. The stretcher bearers are supposed to look after the wounded and dying. The fighting men are supposed to keep on fighting. The troops advanced so far that day that it was necessary to move division headquarters forward to the town of Chappie. So they went from here up to here, and they went around Vauquois up to Chappie. Major McDonald went with it as division postmaster. Word was received in the natural course of events that Lieutenant McDonald was killed. He was killed by a machine gunner, German machine gunner, while leading his men up Vauquois Hill, unquote, the report said. It was passed to Major McDonald, sitting there at an improvised desk in the long, low stone building formerly used by the Boche as sleeping quarters for the 35th Division. "My boy killed leading his men," the major repeated half out loud, while the tears that he tried to hold back made two tiny streams down his cheek. "My boy killed leading his men," he repeated once more, his eyes still on the message, which he could not see. His mind was someplace else. It might have been back in St. Joe, back home, or it might have been picturing the scene of the charge of Aquia Hill. I don't know. I cannot read minds. A little later, Colonel Hawkins, chief of staff, was startled by a man demanding over his shoulder, "I want a battalion, and I want it right away," the voice said. The colonel looked around. Officers weren't in the habit of addressing the chief of staff in a voice like that. He recognized Major McDonald. He knew about the boy's death. "Haven't got a thing," he told the major. But the major was not to be put off. He knew, they all thought he was too old, that he wasn't physically able to stand the strain of the days and nights of exposure living under fire without food or sleep or heat. But he knew he was good for all of those things. Colonel Hamilton S. Hawkins was chief of staff on the morning of the Argonne battle. "Why are you so insistent upon getting a battalion?" I asked the major that morning. We are all apt to ask a lot of foolish questions in time of stress. "Command a battalion?" he repeated. "Why, they killed my boy. Those Boche machine gunners killed him, and he was only a boy. But they can't kill my boy and get away with it, not while I'm alive. They will have to kill me too." He cried as he told me his initials and address and answered the other questions a newspaper correspondent is compelled to ask. It was not the ordinary crying, but more like the overflowing of a broken heart, the giving up of all that life held dear to him, showing itself in two steady little streams that trickled down the inside corners of his eyes. His voice was just as firm and steady as it ever was as he answered my questions. It was difficult to associate the tears and voice with the same man at the same time. And so I left him there, standing in the mud and drizzling rain, a lonely figure in his helmet and gas mask at the alert position, waiting, waiting, waiting for an opportunity to avenge the death of his boy. The shortage of officers became acute as the morning report came in. Something had to be done. "Where's that old man that wanted a battalion?" General Traub asked. "Send him up and we'll see what we can do." The general dismissed the matter from his mind. He had too many other things to think about. The major had his chance. A few minutes later, I saw him, 45 caliber automatic strapped around his waist, outside his raincoat. He was swinging on the back end of an ambulance on his way towards Charpentry to report to the headquarters of the 139th Infantry, where he had orders to be assigned to his former battalion, the one with which his boy was fighting when he died. That was the last time I saw Major McDonald. I wrote the story, but because of the censorship, was unable to use names and dates or places or localities. The thing slipped my mind after that. Here was the original story. Otto P. Higgins, "Our Men Whip the Best," written on September 30, 1918, and appeared in the Kansas City Star October 27, 1918. "At the headquarters of the troops yesterday morning, I found a major. He was a lawyer in St. Joseph, Missouri before the war was declared, and for 37 years he had been a member of the Missouri National Guard. He is now 68 years old. Because of his age, he was relieved of his command and placed in charge of postal work for his troops. His son, a lieutenant of infantry, had been killed the day before in the advance. With tears running down his wrinkled cheeks, the father had pleaded with the commanding general to be assigned to command a battalion that he might lead them against the Boche to avenge the death of his son. 'But you're too old,' the commander protested. 'You can't stand up under the strain. Your age won't permit it. Can't be done.' But the major was insistent with his pleas. And not until the commander gave the order to assign him to a battalion was he satisfied. And then he was almost happy. 'I'll make them regret it,' he told me. 'The Boche can't kill my boy and get away with it. They'll have to pay in blood. And while I'm at it, I will collect for some of the other boys too.'" Otto P. Higgins. The original story was written on September the 30th, published October 27th, as I said, a month later. And it was followed up 6 months later, 10 days after Otto landed at Newport News on April the 20th, 1919. It was a story that Higgins could not let go until he could get the rest of it from Major McDonald's commanding officer, Colonel Carl L. Verstein. "I attended a dinner dance at the Hotel Chamberlain last night," Higgins said, "given by Colonel Verstein to the officers of the 139th Infantry. In talking over old times, the colonel mentioned Major McDonald's name. How did he make out in the Argonne, I asked, when he went up to take one of your battalions? He did some of the finest work of any officer performed, the colonel answered. He took charge with courage and determination. He reorganized the battalion and he held the left end of the division sector, and it was a tough one, took part in the attacks and helped to repel all the enemy counterattacks. He led his battalion there for 3 days, 3 nights. I don't know how he could stand the strain, but he did it. Nothing was too dangerous for him. Nothing could stop him. He worked like he was inspired. He did so well that he was cited in both divisional and regimental orders for his good work." And here's the citation by Colonel Hawkins. General Orders Number 88, 27 October 1918. "The division commander takes pleasure in citing in general orders the following named officer, whose courage and devotion to duty in the face of the enemy is typical of the fighting of this division. Major Clay C. McDonald, 139th Infantry, until September 28, Postal Agent, 35th Division. Learning of the death of his son, first lieutenant of this division, he came forward to the front lines and volunteered for service. He was assigned to command a battalion and conducted himself with courage and good judgment. And although 61 years of age, endured a great physical hardship with a fortitude and determination that would have done credit to many a younger man. He didn't come back with his outfit?" I asked. "No," the colonel said. "He made such a great record there in those 3 days that he was promoted to a higher grade and became a lieutenant colonel and was assigned to duty with the 81st Division. I understand he's now home. He avenged his boy's death too, time after time after time." Lieutenant Colonel Clay Campbell McDonald also served with the 338th Infantry 85th Division and was overseas May 19, 1918 until 2 April 1919. Lieutenant Colonel McDonald died in 1925. He's buried at Mount Moriah Cemetery, St. Joseph, Missouri. Born 5 June 1857, he was 68 when he died. His son was 26. The McDonald story not only dramatizes Higgins' ability to place the reader in the event as they unfolded, but demonstrates the reporter's dogged determination in getting his story. His reporter's instinct for prompting his interviewee to tell the story that his reader wants to hear. The McDonald story contains all of the characteristics William Rockhill Nelson wanted in a good and gifted reporter. And so you see, Higgins had his own highly effective weapons of war. The camera telling the story of what you didn't see. A prose text telling the story in spite of the details that he couldn't tell when the censorship was on. And legs to follow up with the rest of his story when the censorship was lifted and the story planted in the reader's mind could be brought back into a ritual retelling. From camera to notebook, to typewriter, OPH brought Kansas City into the war. And General Pershing himself acknowledged that. "My dear Mr. Higgins," the general began, "it gives me great pleasure to express for you, for myself and my staff and the troops, our appreciation of the services you've rendered to the Army and to the public at home during your stay with the American Expeditionary Forces. You had exceptional opportunities for observing the battles which American troops were engaged and the progressive stages of the Army's development, and you have written fully and intelligently for the benefit of the people of your section of the country. You've had the great responsibility of keeping the people of Kansas and Missouri adequately and accurately informed of the Army and its activities. and I was glad to feel that you have performed these duties in a highly satisfactory manner. Believe me, very truly yours, John J. Pershing. And when General Pershing said, believe me, you did. And now I will close with one last story that, to my knowledge, was never been published in the Star and is now in the National World War I Museum and Memorials Archives, and with the museum's permission today published in this book. The story doesn't have a title, but I'm calling it Mon Enfant for reasons that you will see. Back in the summer of 1914, just as Germany started its invasion of Belgium, the French began mobilizing troops. In the little village of Essay, near the town of Saint-Mihiel, and only a few yards from Nancy by motor vehicle, lived a happy little French family, a father, a mother, and their dark-haired, brown-eyed, five-year-old daughter. The father was a lieutenant in a French regiment of artillery, but he lived at home, something not unusual in the French army. The day he received his orders, he called his wife and daughter to him and telling them what had happened. "It won't be very long," he told them. It'll be over in a few months. We will drive the Boche beyond the Rhine." French women have lived in the shadow of war all their lives. And when Pierre, that's not his real name, but it'll do, told his wife and daughter, they believed and were happy. Because for once and for all, the Boche menace that had threatened and continuously would be ended. Wasn't it worth a few months of war to put an end to it all? Nothing seemed to be able to stop the Boche advance. On and on they came, sweeping everything, destroying and pillaging, sending the civilians back to Germany to work the factories and the mines, dismantling and shipping to Germany what was needed of the industrial machinery. They went on through Belgium and northern France, and finally, they were stopped. The line on the east became more or less permanent. Both the French and the Germans dug in. The Germans made themselves at home, and from the permanency of the buildings, it looked like they were expected to remain forever. At Saint-Mihiel, the line stuck out. There's that line sticking out. Saint-Mihiel is right there. The town of Issy was included in the territory occupied by the Boche. There's Metz. That was where we were headed. And down in here, it's not quite on the map, but it's about right there. Now, this is looks like it's a long ways, but it's not. Artillery can take that pretty easily. There's Thiaucourt. So it's right in here. Here, the Boche officers were billeted in Issy, and the soldiers occupied the barns. It wasn't directly in the front line, but behind it, so that it seldom was under any shell fire, but now and then it was bombed. And for the Boche kept many supplies in the neighborhood, and two main railroads intersected the center of the village. Here the French civilians and the Boche lived together. The newspapers were filled with stories of atrocities, rape, murder, deportation, slavery. Then the Americans. Finally, they came, saviors of the country. June 6th, which we know from World War II is an important day, that memorable day when the 5th and 6th Marines stopped the Boche in Belleau Wood, and the regulars threw back the Hun hordes at Chateau Thierry. France once more began to have a little hope. Paris was deserted, practically. Everyone had been warned to leave. The hotels were as vacant as a haunted house. Everyone who could had gone south, for France had almost given up. But June 6th and the days following revived their falling spirits, and once more they breathed, those who had remained in the most wonderful city in the world and felt as though they had a chance. Time after time, Pierre tried to get word through to his wife. He sent harmless letters to Switzerland to friends, hoping they might get in communication with her, but these were never answered. Once, when he was convalescing in a Paris hospital from a shrapnel wound, he took the matter up with the French intelligence section, to get word of her. Another time, he spent his entire permission, that's his leave, with the various relief societies, hoping he could get word through by them. One fight followed another. The Boches were thrown back in their monster champagne drive by General Gouraud's army and the Rainbow Division. September 12th, the Americans, in their first major offensive, in their first real fight without French assistance, in one swoop, wiped out the entire San Miguel salient, freeing territory that for 4 years had been occupied by the Boches. The Boches knew that the attack was coming, but they didn't know just when. But they warned the civilian population to leave, and most of them did. A few preferred to remain behind, sit hidden in their cellars and take a chance. But most of them withdrew, not knowing what to expect. The Americans swept through, cleaning up everything as they went. And when the kink in the line was straightened out, they stopped and they dug in, consolidating the line. Many of the towns suffered from American artillery. And about 2 days after the Boche withdrew, the Boche began systematically shelling the roads and villages, destroying whatever else was left. They knew every inch of that territory, and they seldom wasted a shell. Nearly every shot told. A sea devoid of civilians was bombarded day and night. Word was flashed over the world of the great American success. Everywhere people went wild. In France, England, America, Italy, it penetrated the French lines by way of the official communique, which every night was distributed by wireless, telephone, and telegraph. About 4 days after the morning that the advance started, a disheveled, unshaven, glassy-eyed man dressed in the uniform of a French lieutenant of artillery was seen to enter the village. He looked neither to the right nor left, neither did he ask any questions. Hurriedly, he picked his way through the traffic of Assay, stopping now and then to look at a half-ruined house, sometimes entering, sometimes passing. No one recognized him. No one knew him. General orders had been issued from time to time during the summer to be always on the watch for spies and never to allow a suspicious-looking character to pass. Word reached headquarters about the mysterious officer who had appeared in the little half-ruined village. The intelligence department, always alive, sent out scouts. The unkempt man, with his wild look in his eyes, had been seen by an MP to enter the garden surrounding what once had been a pretty little stone cottage. A section of the front had been shot away, and part of one room had been left, the furniture in perfect order, just as though the missing section had been sliced off with a knife. Here, the intelligence man entered. In the next room, a combination dining room and kitchen, they saw a figure in French gray, the gold braid on his arm indicating that he was a lieutenant. Sitting on a chair, his head buried in his arms, which rested on the table. On the table was a little worn-out shoe, such as a child would have, and a rag doll with the stuffing gone from one leg. Tightly clasped in his hand was a blue and white, cheap gingham dress, a dress just large enough for a little child. Not a sound came from the figure, not a sob or a quiver, not until one of the soldiers dropped a heavy hand on his shoulder and gave him a jerk, did the man look around. "Mon enfant," he said, holding out the dress in both hands, "mon enfant." And again, his head dropped to the table. The two soldiers took him to headquarters, between them, each holding an arm, for the glassy stare in his sunken eyes made them watchful. He sat down in a chair in the intelligence office while his credentials were examined. Not a word did he say, not a tear did he shed. The next day, he told his story to an officer from the French mission. It was Pierre. For me, 100 years later, addressing you in this cavern below Memory Hall, "Mon enfant" is addressed to a memorial, as a memorial, to the adult world just beyond us, to those who make the wars and who promise the next generation that wars bring better times. Ironically, though, as Mon Enfant demonstrates, the promise of war is a lie. Once the fight is over, and the men who have fought return transformed by moral injury, the men who made the promise, the so-called intelligence of the armies, cannot recognize the transformation and suspect that the morally injured men who fought are now the enemy in disguise. The homes to which the morally injured return are sliced open as if by a knife, and all that remains of the wives and mothers and children who were once alive there are empty shoes and lifeless dresses. After that, all that remains is the story itself, the symbol to be repeated in ritual over and over again, appealing to the intelligence of those of us who witness now, through the reporter's writing, spring and winter, Memorial Day and Armistice Day. That is, I think, the enduring conclusion to Otto's job of writing up the war. So now that the story is written, what has happened 100 years later to the camera, the leather pouch, and the typewriter? What remains of them? We don't know what happened to the camera, but the pictures it took still remain. And we don't know what happened to the leather pouch, but notebooks and stories still remain. And Otto thanked Sergeant Jack Helmick when he met him, along with four other Kansas City Star employees, in the barracks at Camp Stewart. Jack used to arrange it so that I could salvage some government paper occasionally when my supply ran low, Higgins reported. The typewriter and the telescoping legs? Well, Otto confessed to what happened to them. After crossing the Meuse River in Stenay at the end of the war, Higgins headed to Nice to see something of the Riviera. But he stopped off at an officer's club in Commercy, and he lost $1,500 in a dice game and had to return to Paris to sell his typewriter. And it's probably still sitting in the back room of a pawn shop somewhere in Paris, waiting to be redeemed. I doubt that he got $1,500 for it, but after the dice game, he probably needed a bottle of wine and a baguette. And the typewriter lost the argument, but it made for a good story. Especially when you read in the book what Otto was carrying with him at the time, and he did not pawn. May is for rituals of memory, for the new life of spring and in that cycle, for the reappearance of Otto's stories 100 years after his return to Kansas City. Otto thanks Sergeant Jack Helmick for the paper on which he wrote his stories, and I would like to ask you to help me to thank the people that helped make the paper and Otto's book a reality. I would like for them to stand and for you to hold your applause for just a minute. First is my daughter Marla, who is a working journalist herself and who, on the spur of the moment, does what all good journalists do, and that is she came up with Story Grabber. The title for this book, Front Lines to Headlines. Otto would be very pleased that a working journalist did that. And next to Marla's sister, and like Otto, a legal professional, my daughter Katie, a reader who represents all the readers of the book because she will promise her dad to read it from cover to cover. Dr. Mary Della Carter has already read the book and, as its editor, fixed it so you could enjoy reading it too. Jonathan Casey, whom you met, the archivist here at the Museum and Memorial, not only offered me the resources of the Edward Jones Research Center and the treasures of the Higgins Collection, but also reviewed my chapter introductions and fixed statements of historical facts so that the historical accuracy of what you read is much improved. Dave Burns, the manager, print manager at Woodneath Press, along with Mark Livingood, I believe Mark is here too, and Stephen Potter brought the resources of the Story Center and the Mid-Continent Public Library to get Otto's book into print so you could check it out at the library, buy it here, and discuss it in a readers group. The Jackson County Historical Society and the persons of Brent Schaldermeyer, who encouraged and championed the cause, and J. Bradley Pace, who wrote the foreword, offered considerable resources in a collaborative venture with the library. To Jonathan Casey, Steve Paul, Bruce Matthews for writing the book blurbs that appear on the back cover, my heartfelt thanks. And to Otto's granddaughters, Bridget Cromer, Sheila Scott, who shared memorabilia and stories of their grandfather. It was Sheila who donated the contents of the old steamer trunk to the National World War I Museum. And in the person of Bridget and Sheila and the network of family who came to Kansas City on the 100th anniversary of Otto's return to the States. I want to thank Elizabeth Higgins and her husband, Otto P. Higgins, for loving to read history, sharing books, and never tiring of putting the two together for a neighborhood kid. And finally, to all of you readers for coming out this evening, taking the time to meet Otto P. and helping National World War I Museum Memorial to continue the rituals of memory by purchasing a copy and reading the stories of the Kansas City Star's correspondent who witnessed and told Kansas City's story of the Great War. I thank you very much.
Folks, you are encouraged to ask Jim questions, and you can go to either mic or raise your hand, and I will come to you. I'm still going to come to you so we can get it on the recording.
Just curious, sir, did you work with anyone at the Star? Did their morgue have anything to do with putting this thing together, or were you able to work with anybody at the Star?
It's a great question. Ironically, at least from what I heard from the Star, their morgue is dead. There is very little left. I talk with Derek Donovan, who is the liaison between the Star, you know, and the readers, and he very graciously, gave me permission to use material, which probably he said it's unnecessary, it's over 100 years old, but he said there's absolutely nothing left there. Because I wanted to know, how much money was he paid, and how did Elizabeth and, the kids get, three kids, how did they get along? So, yeah, I was not able to find anything else. It was all in the paper, so it's kind of gone. It's a great question. It's one of those things where history disappears. Yeah.
What did the P stand for in his name?
Well, it stood for Paul, Otto Paul Higgins. And I'm not sure, who he was named after. His father was James. He came from Ireland, an immigrant from Ireland. As far as I know, the interesting thing too is that Otto spoke fluent German. And I think one of the reasons that he got that gig as the Star's correspondent was that he knew German fluently. And there's some good stories in the book about that. Both of his grandmothers lived there with him in Kansas City, Kansas. One of them spoke German and no English, and the other one, English and no German. So Otto learned English and German and, translated between the two of them. Then later on, he went to high school, Kansas City, Kansas High School, which is now Wyandotte, and he took the modern language series of studies. So I think that was one of the reasons that got him interested and appointed the Star's reporter, but I'm not sure where the middle name came from. Yeah.
Okay. I've got two questions. One,
sure.
We don't have any total U.S. correspondents went to France and were involved in the war or reported on the war. And secondly, what were the logistics of a reporter at the front line? Were they actually in the trenches or were they back in headquarters? Were they actually embedded as we kind of think about it today?
Sure.
In combat units actually moving up with the units. What were the logistics at that time?
Okay,
what
great. Yeah, great question. Did everybody hear that okay? Okay, the gentleman asked, was how many reporters, American reporters, were overseas? Otto, there's an article that he wrote about writing up the war, that one caption, it's in the book. He said 42, and that seems to be pretty accurate. There was a book written in 1959, Emmett Crozier, who worked at the Star at one time, and Otto knew him very well, wrote a book about the Western reporters on the Western Front. And the second part of the question was, where were these guys? Were they all in Paris or, you know, hanging out, or what, did he in the trenches? He spent a lot of time in the trenches. He went out on patrols, and there's two of those missions stories in the book, and that A.P. Kellogg, you know, the one that I sent, was really touched by that article, was responding to one of those articles. It was incredible. And, you know, he told the story of being out there, lying out. He went out with the men of the 140th, the Kansas City Infantry, and also with the 119th Field Signal Battalion, went out on a patrol as well. And so, yeah, he was in the trenches. He went from unit to unit, ambulance units, stretcher bearers, ammunition train, field signal battalion, infantry, artillery, all of these men from this area, Kansas City, many of whom we knew, he was out there with them in the fight. I talked to him one time about this, you know, and I was just kind of a kid. And I asked him, you know, were you really ever under fire? He said, constantly. And he would have to, he told me, he had to take his typewriter, pull it up. The shells were coming over so fast, and he had to get out of there. He had to leave. And there are times here when, in the stories in here, when he's typing and he stops typing, and starts up again. He says, "My hands have been shaking so bad I can hardly type." He typed that, and it was in a story and sent to the Star. And later on, he was asked, "Well, you know, are these reports that we're reading, are they really true?" And he said, "They're true. They're true." And he explains why, you know, people would not lie about that. Because the whole thing about sensational journalism, you know, with Yellow Press, you know, Hearst newspapers. So Hearst, William Randolph Hearst, is famous for saying, "I'll supply the war. You write the story." Well, that's not true about this war. So 42 American correspondents by Otto's count, and they were gradually, there was the censorship, and all of the censorship papers are here in the book that he received when he got over there, so you can see, and I try to express, you know, what he wrote under censorship and what he was able to write, you know, after he got back and named everybody. But yeah, this comes from experience, and it's first person experience, and you'll see that in the book. It's a great question. Yes, sir.
Actually, Bill. I'm sorry to cut you off. Oh. That was our last question, but okay. Everyone, including you, are available to come to our lobby, and Jim will answer all of your questions. On behalf of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, thank you for joining us. We hope you come back, and another round of applause for Jim Heiman. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.